So we'll be discussing in brief about lower tract trauma. We discussed upper tract trauma before. So broadly, lower tract trauma comprises of bladder and urethral injury primarily, and lower uretric injuries. So broad category is pelvic fracture generally associated with bladder and urethral injury, and sometimes rarely uretric injury. One. Number two is bladder injuries independent of pelvic fracture. And third is urethral injuries. There are various causes of urethral injuries apart from trauma and pelvic fracture. So what all injuries can happen? As you can see in this diagram, blow to the lower abdomen, burst of bladder into peritoneum. As you can see here, there is a bladder, and when the bladder is full, if bladder is full and there is a blow to the lower abdomen, the bladder, once it becomes full, it becomes intraperitoneal. So once there is a blow to bladder in full bladder, the rupture of bladder will cause extravasation into the peritoneum, which is called as intraperitoneal bladder rupture, which needs exploratory laparotomy and repair of the bladder. Other causes are fracture of the pelvis, as you can see, will cause extraperitoneal rupture of the bladder. Extraperitoneal bladder rupture can be managed conservatively with Foley's catheterization, because the extravasation will be confined to extraperitoneum. So extraperitoneal bladder rupture, as you can see here. Okay. Then this C, you can see this is bladder, bladder neck, prostate, and prostatomembranous junction. Prostatomembranoprostatic junction is a fixed part. The whole other urethra is little mobile, but membranoprostatic junction is a fixed part of the urethra. So when there is a pelvic fracture or trauma, this fixed part gets disrupted, so which will cause membranoprostatic injury, membranoprostatic urethral injury, or posterior urethral injury, or also known as pelvic fracture urethral distraction defect, PFUDD. Pelvic fracture urethral distraction defect, or current nomenclature for that is pelvic fracture and urethral injury, PFUI. Okay, then the injury can be in the bulbar urethra, and then it depends whether the injury is, this is urogenital diaphragm, so whether injury is above urogenital diaphragm or below urogenital diaphragm. Here you can see, and blow in perineum, like in straddle injury, like a man, you have seen a very famous picture given in Love Valley, the man falls in a pothole, so there will be a straddle injury, or some baby or kid sitting in the previous bicycle used to have a central rod, so babies used to sit there, so that can cause straddle injury. Classic is pothole injury, so that can cause injury to anterior urethra. Till here it is anterior urethra, which is penile urethra and bulbar urethra. So injuries can be a simple bruising of the urethra, or it can be partial rupture of urethra, or it can be a complete transection or complete rupture of urethra. Blood at meatus is very important sign of injury. Blood at meatus is very important sign of injury, especially injuries distal to urogenital diaphragm. So as you can see in X-ray pelvis here, the landmarks, though it is very difficult to read, see, this is very important. You should know the anatomical landmark of the pelvis. So always, whenever you obtain a plain X-ray, scout X-ray in case of trauma, you should be aware of your landmarks. The fifth lumbar vertebra, posterior superior iliac spine, acetabulum, femoral head, this is all you know, femoral neck, greater trochanter, lesser trochanter, femur, symphysis pubis, the ischial tuberosities, obturator foramen, superior and inferior rami of pubic bone, anterior superior iliac spine, and ileum and iliac crest. So this is the normal urethrogram that we have discussed before. Tip of pen is anterior or penile urethra. From here the bulbar urethra starts. This is penoscrotal junction where bulbar urethra starts. Then there is a external sphincter, prostate and bladder neck. So various methods to these things you should know. Cystogram is either you can fill the bladder from down, or if down catheter is not possible, you have to fill the bladder suprapubically. You can see whether there is any extravasation of contrast from bladder, then whether it is extraperitoneal, intraperitoneal, or bladder neck injury, or there is any reflux, that you can make out. And here you can see Foley's catheterization, suprapubic catheterization, and external fixator being placed for pelvic fracture. So pelvic fracture more commonly occurred due to crush injury or runover injury. It has very high bleeding. It can cause significant bleeding. So the mortality rate is around 20%. Usually it is occult. So pelvic X-ray has to be done to rule out any pelvic fracture. Abdominal and pelvic CT is a must in a trauma case to rule out any missing injuries. Then urethrogram, retrograde urethrogram, as we discussed before in investigation part. All cases of pelvic fracture has to undergo retrograde urethrogram, and non-pelvic fracture cases where blood is there at the tip of meatus, as a sign, retrograde urethrogram has to be done. In 10% male and 5% female pelvic fracture, bladder injury can occur together. Generally the injury is anteroposterior compression of the pelvis and bladder. 60% of bladder injuries are extraperitoneal, 30% are intraperitoneal, and 10% are combined. So about pelvic fracture you should know the classification, which is most important. There are few other classifications also, but the one you should know is Thiel's classification. So it can be classified as stable fracture or unstable fracture. Stable fracture means it can withstand physiological forces. So the patient or the pelvic bone, the physiological forces are standing, running, sitting, bending, it can withstand. Unstable, it cannot withstand, it will dislocate if it is unstable pelvic fracture. Tiles classification is tiles A, tiles B, tiles C, and then further subdivided into A1, A2, B1, B2, B3 and C1, C2, C3. So A is a stable, B is rotationally unstable, C is rotationally and vertically unstable. This you should know. Here you can see A is stable, B is horizontally or rotationally unstable, and C is both vertically and horizontally unstable. What other signs you should see is major injury, which are the telltale signs is ecchymosis or the pelvis can hint you about the underlying pelvic fracture and bladder or urethral injury. Hematoma in the imaging, as you can see, large hematoma is there around iliac crest, and iliac fracture, as you can see in the reconstructed CT image, there is iliac crest fracture. So these things should be give you a caution of underlying bladder or urethral injury. So 10-15% of bladder injury is secondary to pelvic fracture. There may have posterior urethral injuries. About 10-15% of pelvic fracture can have only posterior urethral injury without bladder injury. There may be associated rectal injury or vaginal injury in females. So digital rectal examination and per-vaginal examination is must in cases of lower tract and pelvic fracture. So what are the signs you should see to suspect associated underlying bladder or urethral injuries? Is blood at the tip of meatus. Hematuria and blood at tip of meatus is different. So you should not get confused with hematuria. Hematuria is blood mixed with urine. Okay. And blood at the tip of meatus, independent of urination, you will see blood at the tip of meatus, independent of urine, is blood at the tip of meatus, which is very important sign of urethral injury. So always you should be able to differentiate, because I have seen lot of confusion when we discuss about blood at the meatus and hematuria. So don't confuse about that. So what are the signs? Blood at the tip of meatus, if there is a hematuria, patient is unable to pass urine, there is a perineal or scrotal swelling. In digital rectal examination, you are not able to feel prostate because, as I told you, the membranoprostatic junction is a... One second. Hello? 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 Haan, bole. Hi, Ashwin. Haan, CLT. हाँ चलेगा चलेगा हाँ हाँ पेरिनियल एंड स्क्रोटल स्वेलिंग बिकॉज ऑफ हिमेटोमा हाई राइडिंग प्रोस्टेट एज आई टोल्ड यू बिकॉज ऑफ डिस्ट्रप्शन ऑफ मेम्ब्रेन प्रोस्टेटिक जंक्शन द ब्लैडर विद प्रोस्टेट विल गो अप सो यू मे नॉट बी एबल टू फील प्रोस्टेट एंड द लास्ट इज व्हेन यू ट्राई टू पास अ कैथेटर यू मे नॉट बी एबल टू पास बिकॉज ऑफ injury to urethra or disruption of membranoprostatic junction. So whether catheterization is safe in pelvic fracture? If there is no blood at piatus, then a gentle attempt is safe. But if there is any resistance or blood at piatus, do ascending urethrogram or retrograde urethrogram. If this is normal, then check an attempt at catheterization can be done. One gentle attempt of catheterization is allowed. If this fails or if there is any resistance while passing the catheter or after passing catheter there is no outflow of urine, then before doing second attempt do a ascending or retrograde urethrogram, and if this comes as normal then do a second attempt. If this is abnormal or doesn't go, you have to do suprapubic catheterization. So what is the management of bladder injury? Extraperitoneal, as I told you, mostly managed conservatively except in few other situations where there are associated other injuries. So extraperitoneal, isolated extraperitoneal bladder injury, catheterized for 2 to 3 weeks and await healing. Intraperitoneal, you have to do immediate open surgical repair of bladder. Posterior urethral injury, you have to put first suprapubic catheterization to drain the urine. And later you can do a delayed repair of the damaged urethra. So what are the other as pelvic fracture when we have discussed in the detail, our other situation where bladder can be injured while doing a iatrogenic injuries, while cystoscopic injury, while you are doing cystoscopy for any other indication, or we are doing bladder biopsy, we are doing bladder stone removal, we are doing prostate surgery, we are doing bladder tumor surgery, or we are doing dilatation of urethra, that time bladder can be injured. Other causes are stab or gunshot injury during caesarean section and hysterectomies, especially obstructed labor, bladder injuries are common. Pelvic fracture, as we discussed before, inebriated with full bladder, patient is inebriated with alcohol or any drug abuse, bladder is full, he has not passed urine, there is a minor blow to lower abdomen, can rupture the bladder. Seat belt injury in a full bladder, so when you are driving a car or you are sitting in the car with the seat belt on and you have a long drive and you have not passed urine for a long time, minor injury in a very full bladder can cause intraperitoneal rupture of bladder. Then augmented bladder, like when the bladder is small and we have done ileal augmentation or colonic augmentation of bladder, that anastomosis part can give way. So as we discussed, intra and extraperitoneal. In intraperitoneal, there will be abdominal distension, bladder will not be felt clinically, patient will not be able to pass urine. While in extraperitoneal, you can see the bladder, you can feel the bladder, you may have bruises in the lower abdomen, patient may pass urine with difficulty or there may be hematuria. In intraperitoneal, usually pelvic fracture may not be associated. There may be other causes of intraperitoneal rupture, but in extraperitoneal, most likely pelvic fracture will be associated. In intraperitoneal, urethral injuries associated are rare, but in extraperitoneal, there may be urethral injury. So in cystogram, as we discussed, extravasation will be into peritoneal cavity, and in extraperitoneal, it will be to extraperitoneum. It will be limited extravasation, as you can see in this figure. You can see full contrast is going into peritoneum. While extraperitoneal, this is limited here only. So this is the important investigation to differentiate between intraperitoneal and extraperitoneal bladder rupture. What are the treatment? As we discussed, intraperitoneal, you have to open, give wash, see the rent in the bladder, repair it in two layers. If it is large, you have to put SPC and catheter along with and a drain. While in extraperitoneal, generally put a catheter and leave for 2 to 3 weeks. While as I told you, in few cases you have to explore in extraperitoneal also when there are you are opening or you are exploring for associated injuries, like there are associated rectal injuries. There is a double transection of bladder. There is a bone spike projecting into bladder which is not going to heal conservatively. They associate vaginal injury, or when the orthopedician is planning to do open fixation of pelvic fracture, that time you can address the extraperitoneal rupture at the same sitting. About urethral injuries, can be anterior urethra, penile and bulbar, or posterior is membranous and prostatic urethra. Anterior urethral injury generally due to straddle injury. It can be as I showed you in the figure before, it can be contusion, partial or complete tear. Posterior may be associated with pelvic fracture. Posterior injury can be supradiaphragmatic or transdiaphragmatic or infradiaphragmatic. Urogenital diaphragm, it can be above, it can be through, or it can be below, just below the urogenital diaphragm. So in anterior urethral injury, you can see butterfly bruise or butterfly hematoma or sleeve-like bruise. In posterior injury, you can see high riding prostate. Urethrogram in anterior urethral injury will show continuity or slight irregularity or leak. And posterior, there are different classification for posterior urethral injuries. You should not go into those details. In anterior urethral injuries, if it is a partial contusion, you can catheterize. If it is a partial, you can catheterize or divert. If it is complete, you divert and repair later. In posterior injuries, you have to divert first, and you can do a delayed repair, which is better, or you can do immediate repair if the exploration is being done for any other causes. So as you can see here in diagram, eggplant deformity, egg implant and butterfly hematoma. So when, how urine and hematoma extravasates? This Buck's fascia, so rupture of urethra in the shaft of penis here. So Buck's fascia is not disrupted, Buck's fascia is intact. So extravasation and hematoma will be within Buck's fascia. So you can see egg implant deformity. But if Buck's fascia is injured, especially when there is an injury to bulb, rupture of Buck's fascia, rupture of urethra bulb, then it will be urine will and hematoma will extravasate up to scarpa's fascia and colles fascia. So you will see huge, large hematoma and contusion. This is called butterfly hematoma. This is egg implant deformity. So anterior urethral rupture, if you are doing primary repair, as you can see, this, there is an injury to urethra here. So you can repair it if the lumen is adequate, primarily repair, or you can augment it with any buccal mucosa or prepucial flap. Posterior urethral injury. As I told you, that different radiographic types of that. So this is urogenital diaphragm, this is posterior urethra, this is normal, this is pubic symphysis. Then what happens here? As you can see, there is an injury, type 1, type 2 is partial, is complete tear, but the distance is less than 2 cm and the defect is more than 2 cm. Type 1 is partial injury or only contusion. Type 2 is disruption with less than 2 cm gap. Type 3 is disruption with more than 2 cm gap. So what you have to do in these cases? Suprapubic cystostomy, suprapubic catheterization. Suprapubic cystostomy can be done by trocar method or open method, where you give a small incision, see the bladder, open it and put catheter, or directly with trocar you can puncture the bladder. And then later you can do repair. As you can see in this figure very well, this is a transected and disrupted part of urethra. This is the posterior urethra, this is the anterior urethra, there is a Foley that has been passed, and with anastomose this anterior to posterior urethra with 6 or 8 interrupted absorbable sutures. What are the complications of posterior fracture, urethral injuries, or posterior urethral injuries and repair? Is bleeding is a very dreaded complication, sepsis, restricture formation, fistula formation, and erectile dysfunction. This is very important. Always take history of erectile dysfunction in a pelvic fracture case before operating patient, because the erectile dysfunction is not because of surgical complication, it's because of damage of the neurovascular bundle which has happened because of trauma. So this was all about lower tract trauma. Do read it well, and then if any doubts you can ask me, and then next class we will discuss about the urinary bladder physiology and anatomy of micturition. Thank you.